We are continuing our teaching series on the foundational doctrines of Christ. I'd like to begin by reading Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 through 3 again. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. So what Paul is saying is, it is God's will for all believers to go on to perfection. The word perfection means full maturity in Christ, complete, lacking nothing in our conformity to Christ. So what's implied is, before we can go on to perfection, we must have these foundational doctrines laid in our lives. And he said, this we will do. We will go on to maturity after we have these foundational doctrines laid. So one of the doctrines we're looking at in this session is the laying on of hands. Now, in our previous session on laying on of hands, we covered laying on of hands for physical healing, laying on of hands to impart the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the laying on of hands to impart spiritual gifts, and the laying on of hands for sending out Christian ministries from the local church. So in this session, we want to look at the laying on of hands for appointing deacons and ordaining elders. In other words, we're recognizing and appointing deacons or elders in the local church. We'll begin by reading from the book of Acts, chapter 6, verse 1. Now in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists, because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. So it's obvious that from this passage, the church had daily food distributions to the widows. And some were Hebrew widows and some were Greek, Hellenists. And the Hellenists were complaining, we're not getting our food. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples, and they said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. In other words, we're not going to get involved in this ministry. If we get involved in serving tables and sorting out which widows got food and who didn't, we'll neglect the time we need in prayer and ministry of the word of God. That's what we're called to as apostles. So he said, it's not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you seven men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to ministry of the word. The apostle said, okay, we've got to stay focused on our calling, which is to give ourselves to prayer and the word. You look out, he said to the congregation, find seven men full of the Holy Spirit, full of wisdom, and they have a good reputation. In other words, they have godly character. So the congregation knows who has godly character. They're with the people. So they found the seven men. They brought them to the apostles. Let's read on. It says, and this saying pleased the whole multitude. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. Then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. So here we see the apostles, they gave the criteria, the qualifications for a deacon. Now, a deacon is not a governmental position. It's a place of servanthood. In other words, it's not a ruling elder that rules over the body, teaching and guiding, shepherding the flock. A deacon is a faithful person, full of the Holy Spirit and godly character, who is a servant of the Lord. So they found these men, and the disciples then prayed, the apostles prayed, and then laid hands on them. They did this in front of all the people. So just like Joshua was ordained by Moses in front of all the people. And after Moses did that, all the people gave heed to Joshua. Now all the congregation would know these seven men have been appointed to this business. They're authorized to do it. They're servants of the Lord, so they would be respected in their job among the body of Christ. Amen. There was an impartation when the apostles laid hands on them and a public recognition of their position as servants. There is a great need today for men and women who will faithfully serve as deacons. The apostles needed the deacons to serve so they could be free to spend their time in prayer and the ministry of the word. Now, when the apostles were freed up to do what they were called to do, the kingdom of God advanced. Let's read again Acts chapter 6, verse 7. It says, "Then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith." So when everyone in the body, would it be wonderful if everyone in the body took their place, found a place to be faithful to serve, that frees up leaders to do their job, which is to give themselves over to prayer and to the ministry of the word. When they did that, the word of God spread. The number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. So there's the laying on of hands for ordaining deacons. Now let's look on the laying on of hands for ordaining elders. An elder is a ruling leader, a shepherd in the body of Christ. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14, the Apostle Paul writes, "Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership." So in the context, this verse suggests Paul was exhorting Timothy regarding his ministry gifting as an overseer of the local church. It was imparted through the laying on of hands of the eldership. In other words, Paul and other elders together laid hands on Timothy. He received an impartation of the Holy Spirit and gifting that would match his calling as a leader in the body of Christ. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, Paul writes to Timothy, "Let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity." He's giving Timothy instructions as an overseer of the congregation. Because Timothy was young, we don't know how young. Maybe he was around 30 or his early 30s. Paul said, "Don't let someone despise your youth, but be an example to them in your conduct, your love, your spirit, your faith, and your purity." And shepherds in the body of Christ are called to be that. We're called to be examples. We're called to lead by example. Then he says, "Until I come, give attention to reading." He's speaking about reading the scriptures, to exhortation, to doctrine or teaching. So Timothy was to be an example in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. His life is to be an example. He's to give himself to reading the scriptures, to exhorting the people, and teaching the doctrines of the Bible as an overseer. And then Paul says, "Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership." Now, he'll tell us in the next verse one of the ways to not neglect that gift. In 1 Timothy, Paul told Timothy that he should stir up the gift or fan the flame as the original Greek. He says, "Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to all." So when we meditate on the Word of God that's been spoken to us, the Word of God that we've read, the Word that we've studied, we meditate and hold it in our heart. And then we give ourselves entirely to the Word to do what God says. That stirs up the gift that's in us. Now, this is parallel with Moses imparting authority and gifting to Joshua. As God established Joshua as leader over the congregation of Israel, in Numbers 27, verse 18, the Lord said to Moses, "Take Joshua the son of Nun with you, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay your hand on him. Set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation, and inaugurate him in their sight. And you shall give of your authority to him, that all the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient." Of course, Moses did that. And in Deuteronomy 34, it says, Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So when deacons and elders are recognized publicly with hands laid on and ordained, not only are they recognized as leaders in their position, but an impartation of the Spirit with gifting comes. Just as gifting came to Timothy, we saw gifting of wisdom came to Joshua when Moses laid hands on him. And again, recognizing and heeding elders in the church is vital. When Moses laid hands on Joshua, it says the children of Israel heeded him, and they did as the Lord had commanded Moses. That was one of the reasons why God wanted hands laid on Joshua, so all the people could recognize, this is my leader, listen to him, and follow him. So in the same way, as Moses ordained Joshua, Paul and the elders, led by the Holy Spirit, ordained Timothy. And because of that impartation received by Timothy, through the laying on of hands, the congregations, they recognized and they heeded Timothy's leadership. So today, believers should be faithfully joined to a local congregation. We should recognize and heed the elder or elders who are over them in the Lord. This is one of the primary reasons, in my opinion, why the laying on of hands is a foundational doctrine. Because through the laying on of hands, leaders are set in office, leaders receive impartation, and people can recognize these are the God-ordained leaders we should follow. And of course, we should follow them if their life is also an example. Okay, not just because of a position, but leaders are to lead by example. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. So if a leader's following Christ, it'll be evident in their life. And you'll be able to see the fruit in their life, and you'll know that's a leader I can follow because the fruit of the Spirit in Christ's likeness is coming forth from their life. So every believer should be rightly connected to the body of Christ. They should know what leader or leaders they are connected to and who they're following. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17 says, obey those who rule over you, and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give an account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you. How can someone obey those who rule over you if you're not connected to a church where there's God-ordained leaders that are teaching you the Word of God and leading by example to help you grow up into the full stature of Christ? If you're not rightly connected to a body of Christ, submitted to your elders, they can't lead you and you can't grow like God intended. Now, the laying on of hands is a foundational doctrine by which we can recognize and heed the God-appointed leaders in the body of Christ. Again, looking at Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, we see that God has given leaders in the New Testament that are called apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Let's read that. Ephesians 4:11. And He, the Lord, Himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. You see, elders, shepherds, leaders, that's what apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers are given to equip the believers to do the work of the ministry. The elders are not to do all the ministry, but to equip the saints to do the ministry. And it says, for the building up of the body of Christ. This is why these elders are given, to build the body of Christ up. How long? It says, until we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. The word knowledge is epinosis. It means experiential knowledge. If we're under God-ordained leaders and we are also following the Lord by spending time in the Word and prayer, being obedient to our leaders, then we will grow into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. Experiential knowledge, it says, epinosis. That means we'll have spiritual experience, revelation in our heart of the Lord Jesus Christ. To a perfect man, that means fully mature, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Again, God gave elders in the body, it says in Ephesians 4, so that we would no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. There are many winds of doctrine blowing around today on the internet, on YouTube, and you can go to this ministry or that ministry and hear strange doctrines. Some of them are appealing to the flesh. And if someone is ignorant of the Word or they're not under good leadership, they can become easily deceived. And so God gave leaders so that believers would not be tossed around by false teachings. Would not be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. By the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. There are ministers who are cunning, crafty, and deceitful. That's what the Bible says. There's some ministers whose ultimate goal is to grow a big ministry. They have hidden agendas of getting money, getting tithes, getting fame, getting recognition, exalting themselves, or who knows what other foul motive. But they're cunning, they're crafty, and they're deceitful. And they'll twist the Word to make it appealing to the ignorant, those who don't know the Scriptures, and so that they can take advantage of you. But if you're under God-ordained leaders that are anointed by God, and you are also doing your part to pray and read the Bible, God will keep you from those deceptions. Amen. It says, not being blown by these wind of doctrines, but speaking the truth in love, we may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. God wants all believers to grow up in everything into Jesus who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies. Now, every joint supplies. Unless someone is connected to the body, how can they receive or give the supply of the Spirit? A joint is formed when people are connected to the body, their heart is connected, they're involved in a local congregation. So God's plan is that all of the body be joined and knit together, and every joint would supply according to the effective working by which every part does its share. There are those today who, contrary to the teachings of the Bible, are not planted in a local church. They don't go regularly attend a church. Some float around. They go from church to church. And so therefore, they cannot be joined and knit together. They cannot give and receive as God intended. And so they're hindering the process that God has given for them to grow up into Christ. So let's review. These God-ordained leaders are given so that, one, the saints can be equipped to do the work of ministry. That means service. Two, the body of Christ would be built up. That means numerically. That means new believers would come. But also we would be built up in the knowledge of Christ and conformity to the image of Christ. Three, believers will come into the unity of the faith. Four, saints will grow in the experiential knowledge of Jesus. Five, believers will come into full maturity, even the full stature of Christ. Six, believers will know the truth so they're not deceived. Amen. So the Word of God is clear. It's His will. The body should be joined and knit together. We should be in a body recognizing leaders. That's one of the primary reasons for the laying on of hands, is to appoint, ordain, recognize leaders, so the body of Christ can heed those leaders, be connected rightly to the body, and grow up into the full stature of Christ. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 and 25. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. He's talking about the second coming of the Lord Jesus is approaching. So we are to consider one another to provoke each other to love and to good works. That's one of the primary reasons why we gather together regularly as a congregation. Because when we gather, we provoke each other to love God, to love each other, and to serve God with good works. He says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. So we are to be connected to the body. Psalm 92, verse 13 and 14 says, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. If we're planted in the house, we'll flourish. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be fresh and flourishing. So in obedience to God, believers should be planted in a local body. They should be serving. Each person there can be equipped to serve. They can grow in relationship with the Lord and with His people. Again, some, in violation to the principles of Scripture, some professing Christians float around from one congregation to another without being committed. That would be like taking a tree, digging it up from the ground, take a fruit tree, dig it up from the ground, and transplant it. And then before it can really mature and bear fruit, dig it up and transplant it again. Then dig it up, transplant it again. Well, that tree will never grow to maturity, and it will be very difficult for it to bear fruit. So it's better to do what God says. Be planted in the house of God and flourish. Amen. So through the laying on of hands, we see that deacons are appointed, elders are ordained, and impartation is given through the laying on of hands. Now, elders are to lead by example. We're to serve as overseers and not lord over God's people. We should be connected to the body of Christ, and we should follow leaders, but not only because someone laid hands on them or because they have a position. We should follow leaders because they have godly character and they are leading an exemplary life. We want to follow their example. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1, Peter writes, the elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Here's his exhortation to the elders. Shepherd the flock which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, not as lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. So when we're connected to a body, yes, you should be planted in a body. Find a leader that you know is ordained by God, that's anointed by God, and that has a life that's an example to be followed. So he tells these leaders to lead by example. Don't do it for money. Don't lord over the people. Leaders are not to control people's lives, but to lead them into the knowledge of Christ, to lead them into a closer walk with Jesus, to lead them in fruitful service to God. So he said, and then when the chief shepherd appears, you shepherds will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. So the younger generation should be submitted to the elder. Yes, all of you be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. Now we will only be anything ever by the grace of God. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, Paul says, I am what I am by the grace of God. The grace of God is the divine empowerment, the divine enablement, the anointing, the strength, the ability to do the will of God. And God says He gives that grace, the ability to do the will of God. He will give that to the humble. And the humble are those who are connected and submitted. Again, not submitted to tyrants, not submitted to people who try to control your life and lord it over you. That's not the kind of way that God tells us to lead. We're to lead by example. We're to lead by having a Christ-like life. But when we find the leaders that we're to be connected with, we're to be submitted. So he said, submit to one another. You younger, submit to your elders. And we're also to submit to one another in the fear of God. But in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, he says, "Therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time." So as we are rightly connected, we're submitted, we're involved, we're obedient. In that humble posture, God pours out his grace. We can grow up into the full stature of Christ. But he says we're to be submitted to one another. How can we all be submitted to one another? Doesn't the Bible say that? It says, be submitted to one another in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. Be submitted to one another in the fear of God. Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3 says that the head of every man is Christ. The head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Now, not every man is head over every woman. That's not what he's saying. He's talking about the marriage relationship. So a husband is under the headship of Christ. The wife is under the headship of her husband. And the children are under the headship of both parents. So to be submitted to one another, the children obey their parents. They're submitted to their parents. The wife is submitted to her husband. The husband is submitted to Christ. Christ is under God the Father. So we're all to be submitted to one another in humility. And in that posture, God gives great grace. Now, if we're not obedient, if a husband is not submitted to God, he won't love his wife properly. 1 Peter chapter 3 tells husbands, beware, because if you're disobedient, your prayers can be hindered. You must treat your wife with honor. And a wife must respect her husband. Children must obey their parents. So we do that, and we're submitted to one another. We're connected to the body of Christ. We're walking in the grace of God. And bondservants and masters, he goes on to say, that would be correlating today to employers' employees. Employers, treat your employees fairly and kindly. Employees, work for your employer as you would for Christ. Be faithful. Do a good job as unto the Lord. So that's what we should do. We should recognize our God-ordained leaders so that we're rightly connected to the body of Christ, rightly relating to our leaders, submitted to one another in the fear of God, in a humble posture, so we're all receiving the grace of God. When we're rightly connected to leaders, we can be equipped to serve, we can avoid false doctrines, we can be knit together in love, and grow up into the full stature of Christ in God. Amen. So there's the laying on of hands for appointing deacons and recognizing and ordaining elders, and how that affects us as believers, recognizing the leaders that God has placed over us. Amen.